Hello, I'm Ben Godwin. Welcome to the Word Workshop, recorded at the Good Springs Full Gospel Church.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy.
My wife Michelle and I have pastored the Good Springs Full Gospel Church since 1999, a Spirit-filled church with a hunger for God and a heart for people. Good Springs Full Gospel Church is located in Walker County on Highway 269, 10 miles south of Jasper.
The prophet said that the knowledge of the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea.
So prepare your hearts to receive from the Word, because when all else fails, God's Word works.
Well, praise the Lord. Before we dig into the Word of God, let me show you a couple things that I thought were interesting. Wait until you see why God made you wait. We don't like to wait, do we? But look at somebody say, there's a reason. God knows best, and He's never late. He's always right on time. Amen. I like this. God uses broken people like you and me to rescue broken people like you and me. Look at somebody say, let God use you. Whatever you've been through, it's for a reason, to help somebody else. Amen. The same God who brought you through will bring them through. Amen. This made me laugh. Somebody posted this. Finally got a date for Valentine's. It's a court date, but still, I get to dress up. And here we go, couples on February 14th, everything's lovey-dovey, and couples on February 15th, hopefully that's not the case. Amen, let love continue beyond the holiday. And this made me laugh. I'm more excited for the day after Valentine's Day, just so I can get all the discounted candy. Well, it's good to laugh, isn't it? Go with me in your Bibles, if you will, please, to the book of John, the Gospel of John. I want to use for a subject today, greatest expressions of God's love. Greatest expressions of God's love. You see there on the slide, God is love. Say that with me. God is love. He's not just a loving God. He is love. He is love defined, love personified. It's who He is, it's what He does, it's in His DNA. He can't do anything apart from love. And think about this, apart from God, there is no true love. You might have emotional feelings, but true love comes from the author of love, who is God. John 15, I want to read a few verses here from this text. We're going to start with verse 9. If you're there, say amen. I'm in the New King James. It says, as the Father loved me, I also have loved you. Abide in my love. Look at verse 12. This is my commandment that you what? Love one another as I have loved you. Notice he said it's a commandment. He didn't say it's a suggestion if you feel like it. It's a commandment. All right, that you love one another as I have loved you. Now, that's impossible. How can you love somebody else the same way God has loved you? Humanly, that's impossible. But how many are glad with God all things are possible? We can't do it within ourselves, but we can do it through the one who is love. Amen? So look at verse 13, we all know it. Greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. You are my friends. How about that? You're a friend of God. You are my friends if you do whatever I command you. No longer do I call you servants, for a servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. Listen, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you. I'm glad you've been chosen. that you should go forth and bear much fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatever you ask the Father in my name, he may give it. These things I command you, and then he reiterates, reemphasizes, say it with me, that you love one another. We are, by human nature, selfish and unloving. That's why you need to be born again, because you get a new nature. You get God's nature, which is loving. The greatest expression of God's love, I believe, is the cross. I can't think of any greater expression of God's love than the cross. God, a greater love has no man than this, than that he lay down his life for his friends. But Jesus went above and beyond that. He didn't just lay down his life for his friends. He laid down his life for his enemies. How many know we were at one time at enmity with God? We were the enemies of God. But how many are glad for the next scripture? I love this passage. Hallelujah. It says, greater love has no man than this, than that a man lay down his life for his friends. But look at this next one, Romans 5:8. But God demonstrated his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He loved us when we were unlovable. He died for us while we were, before we were even born, and he knew we would be at enmity against him so he could reconcile us back to himself. If that isn't love, somebody tell me what is. Hallelujah. What a mighty God we serve. You've all heard the Dottie Rambo song, right? The old song, If That Isn't Love. Remember that song? You probably sung that here before, Donnie. Let me give you the lyrics. He left his splendor in heaven, knowing his destiny was the lonely hill of Golgotha, there to lay down his life for me. If that isn't love, the ocean is dry. There's no stars in the sky, and the sparrow can't fly. If that isn't love, heaven's a myth. There's no feeling like this if that isn't love. How many thank God he loved you when you were unlovable? But love must be expressed. You see, love must find expression, and it's expressed through giving. We all know John 3:16. God so loved the world, what did he do? He gave his only begotten son. It's hard to hide true love. If you really love somebody, it's hard to hide. It's like trying to hold a sneeze. You ever tried to hold a sneeze before? Man, I have. About blew my brains out the back of my head. You ever try to cough? You ever be somewhere, you know, maybe in a funeral or somewhere, and you got a little cough, and you're trying to muffle it? It's hard to hide a cough. Hard to hide a pregnancy. There's some things you just can't hide. Well, if you really love God, it's going to be evident in the way you live. If you really love people, it's going to manifest in how you treat them. Love is not just in what you say. Love is in what we do. And I'm glad God didn't just say he loved us. He proved his love. He demonstrated his love. He expressed his love by sending his own son to save us. He came to this hellhole. He came to this cesspool of sin called earth to redeem us and to buy us back to himself. How many thank God for his love? Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus, for your love. There's an old saying I like. Goes like this: a bell is not a bell until you ring it. A song is not a song until you sing it. Love in your heart is not put there to stay. Love isn't love until you give it away. Valentine's, of course, is known as the season of love, romance. The day we express love by giving, exchanging gifts. Some people actually tie the knot. They exchange their wedding vows. Did anybody that's present get married on or around Thanksgiving, Valentine's Day? Anybody? Nobody? Everybody? Somebody? All right. My sister Cindy, I was texting her yesterday to get the story straight. She and her husband Keith, they got married 30 years ago, the day after Valentine's Day. Baton Rouge, Louisiana. We were there. I'll never forget it. She reminded me that me and my sister, mischievous as we were, got a bunch of Oreos and stuck it to their car, and they had to go by and get it hosed off on their honeymoon. And she was texting me, and she meant to say, God has been so good and faithful, because they've been married 30 years, and autocorrect got her. How many have ever been burned by autocorrect? You better edit what you text before you hit send. Well, it wasn't too bad, but it was hilarious. It said, God has been so gooey. God has been so gooey. Well, that's probably more right than wrong, because he is so in love with you, his bride. Hallelujah. He just wants to slobber kisses all over you. God is so, look at somebody say, God is so gooey. Hallelujah. And God is so good. But this is a crazy, crazy little sidebar. I'll get back to my sermon in a minute, but let me tell this story. Keith's family had a weird tradition that whenever anybody got married, especially the men in their family, at the wedding reception, they would present to them a ball and chain, a literal ball and chain. And he had two brothers, and they, after the end of the reception, they're about to, you know, go off for their honeymoon, they literally bolted, I mean padlocked, a shackle to his ankle. It had a chain and a big heavy ball, a metal steel ball. And Keith knew about this, of course, being in the family a long time, and he thought he had outwitted them. He thought he had them all outsmarted. He had a pair of bolt cutters in his trunk, but his brothers outsmarted Keith and removed the bolt cutters. And Keith and my sister had to stop at a fire station and got the firemen to cut off the bolt cutters, and they sprayed all the Oreos off the car too. So the whole moral of that story is God is so gooey. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Listen, love in marriage is not a ball and chain. That's how some people view it, but they don't view it through God's eyes. Let me tell you what the Bible says. Proverbs 18:22, the man who finds a wife finds a good thing, the King James says. I like the NLT, New Living Translation says, finds a treasure. And he receives favor from the Lord. Love is not a ball and chain. Love is a blessing. Love is a privilege. It's not a burden, it's a blessing. Hallelujah. And if you have a living spouse, you need to express your love to them. You need to not just say you love them, you need to prove it with how you lived and how you treat them. Good preaching, Brother Ben. Hallelujah. I got to remind you of this every year, of course. Valentine's Day, the origin of that is pretty interesting. Saint Valentine was a priest who was executed on February 12th, 270 AD. He secretly married couples in ancient Rome against the emperor Claudius II's wishes. He felt that if his soldiers got married, it made them soft, it weakened them. So Saint Valentine would secretly marry these soldiers, and that's how this tradition kind of began. In fact, legend has it that Saint Valentine prayed for and healed a judge. His name was Asterius. His daughter was blind, and this judge had sentenced him to die, but she came to visit, and he prayed for her, and supposedly she was healed, and his last words were written on a note signed this, from your Valentine. And of course, the rest is history. Valentine is a 20 plus billion dollar industry now. Chocolate, jewelry, cards, candy, flowers, dinner, movies. You better watch out. Stupid Cupid is shooting his arrows. But love is a two-way street. Love must be returned to be complete. Love must be given and received. It's give and take. It's a two-person sport, if you will. If you've ever played ping pong or tennis, it's not much fun by yourself, or volleyball. You need somebody on the other side to return the ball. And that's how love is. It's give and take. It's give and receive. It's a two-way street. And if it's all one-sided, it doesn't last very long. You know I'm telling you the truth. Now, let me give you five ways that we express our love. This is real practical. You may want to jot these down. When Michelle and I were engaged, we read several books together. One of them was Gary Chapman's book called The Five Love Languages. I just want to mention them real quickly because I think it'll help somebody. How do we express our love? How do we give and receive our love? There's five main ways. Number one is with words of affirmation. How many believe husband and wife ought to encourage one another, not tear down each other with their words? Oh, we're not shouting, but that's good preaching. We need to say supportive, loving things to our partner. Listen, words can heal or words can harm. You remember that old jingle we used to sing on the playground when we were kids? Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. Baloney. Not a bit of truth to that. Words do hurt people. That's why we got to be careful what we say. Your words can either be destructive or your words can be constructive. You can either tear people down with your words or build people up with your words. How many are glad Jesus builds his bride up with his word? Well, we need to do the same thing. Amen? We need words of affirmation. Words are powerful. You heard about Michelle reminded me of this old story I'd forgotten about. This woman, she was depressed and she was just down and she was moping and crying. And her husband said, "What's wrong? What's the matter?" She said, blubbering, her chin quivered. She said, "You never tell me you love me anymore." He said, "I told you I loved you when we got married. And if I change my mind, I'll let you know." That's not going to cut it, guys. I said, that's not going to cut it. How many times have you heard Jesus loves you? Every time you hear it, it means something. You need to express your love with words of affirmation. Don't criticize and put down your spouse with destructive words. Lift them up. Encourage them. Let them know you value them. They are worth something to you. Here's the second way we express our love is through acts of service. Do helpful things for your partner. I know, guys, we don't like to do it, but it helps to wash dishes once in a while. I heard one preach from a woman over here. Help cook, help clean, help fold laundry, help vacuum. Love is not just words, it's proven in actions. We all know faith without works is dead. How about this? Love without works is dead. If it's all talk, then it's empty. There needs to be some action. Let me give you a scripture. 1 John 3:18. My little children, let us not love in word, neither in tongue, but love in deed and in truth. Another version says this. Let us stop saying we love people. Let us really love them and show it by our actions. How many remember the old saying, actions speak louder than words? Talk is cheap, folks. Except when Congress does it. True love is displayed by how we treat people. And listen, this is a bombshell. The way we treat people is the way we treat God. Jesus said, inasmuch as you do it to the least. However you treat the least is how you treat me. That hits right here, doesn't it? All right, here's the third way we give and receive love. Giving of gifts. How many likes presents? Oh, don't sit there and look so sanctified. You know you like stuff. This lets your partner know you care about them. You've been thinking about them. The gifts don't have to be expensive. It doesn't have to be a new car. Just something thoughtful. Love is expressed through giving. God so loved the world, he gave. When we give someone we love something, we are imitating the divine example. We are being like God. Praise the Lord. There's an old saying I like. You can give without loving, but you can't love without giving. If you love, you're going to give. Praise the Lord. And here's a fourth way. How about this? Quality time. Spend meaningful time with your spouse, your partner. And this is getting harder and harder, folks, in the culture we live in. Everybody's busy. Everybody's distracted. We got 1,000 things we're trying to do. You're not going to like this, but I'm going to preach it anyway. Sometimes we just need to put down the cell phone and talk to each other. And I'm guilty too. We get so caught up in our notifications and so caught up in all of our stuff that we sit there by the person who's supposed to mean the most to us and we ignore them. And that's not right. I said it's not right. Quality time. Give your spouse your undivided attention regularly. God help us all. And then there's the fifth way that we express our love for one another, and that's with physical touch, holding hands, a pat on the back, a shoulder rub, arm around somebody. Now, let me be real clear. I don't want any ambiguity here, all right? If you're unmarried, keep your hands to yourself. If you are married, that's a different story. Keep hugging. Keep snuggling. Keep kissing. And you're not going to like this. Keep making love. When was the last time you heard a preacher say that? Oh, you're just saying that. No, it's right out of the Bible. I'll give you the scripture. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 7:3-5. Let the husband render to his wife the affection due her. Likewise also the wife to her husband. Do not deprive one another except with consent for a time that you may give yourself to fasting and pray and come together again so Satan doesn't tempt you because of your lack of self-control. Look at somebody say it's in the book. In the book. I know some of you are really ready for lunch now. Let me give you four greatest instances in which Jesus expressed his love through actions. It's going to take a minute. Four of the greatest instances in which Jesus expressed his love through his actions, not just his words. Number one, are you ready? Number one, Jesus washed his disciples' feet, including Judas. John 13 tells the story. After the Last Supper, Jesus laid aside his outer garment, wrapped up in a towel. He poured a basin of water. He began to wash the disciples' feet, including Judas's feet. That blows my mind right there, friend. He knew full well what Judas was about to do in a few minutes, but he washed his feet anyway. You say, oh, you just don't know. They've mistreated me. Yeah, show them the love of God. Maybe it'll melt that hard heart. Who knows what God will do? Amen? In Bible times, it was a servant's job to wash people's feet, but none of them were rich enough to have servants. So it was DIY. You know what that means? Do it yourself. And that's what they usually did. But this time, Jesus shocked them all. Imagine the king of the universe stooping down with a basin of water and begins to wash the dirty, stinky feet of a bunch of fishermen. If that isn't love, I don't know what is. And of course, Peter got all pious, you know. Lord, you'll never wash my feet. Jesus said, if I don't wash your feet, you'll have no part with me, buddy. And then he went to the other extreme. Lord, not just the feet, but the hands, the head. Give me a whole bath. Jesus said, that's not necessary. Some people call it basin theology. I want you to think about this for just a minute. Which basin will we choose? Pilate used a basin to wash his hands and to get out of involvement. Jesus used a basin to humble himself and get involved. Here's the question. Which basin will we choose? Will we choose to not be involved, or will we choose to deliberately get involved? Which basin will we choose? You get anything out of this? Number two, how about this? Jesus healed Malchus's ear. Did you know this is the last person Jesus healed that is recorded in the Bible while he was on earth? Now, he performed other miracles after his resurrection, but there are no other documented cases where he healed somebody. And you know the story. Malchus was the servant of the high priest. He was in the arrest mob who came to capture Jesus. And when he said, "Who do you seek?" And they said, "We're looking for Jesus of Nazareth." And he said three words. What power was in his voice? "I am he." And the Bible said in the book of John, the whole mob hit the ground because they could not stand before the power that was in his voice. But then, you know, they kind of gathered themselves and he said, "Who are you looking for?" "Oh, we want Jesus. I am he. But let these others go. Take me. Let them go." And then all of a sudden a scuffle breaks out. And Peter whips out his sword and thinks he's got to defend Jesus. Come on. Let me tell you, Jesus can handle himself. He said he could have called 12 legions of angels, hallelujah, to intervene for him, but he didn't do it. But Peter pulls out his sword, and I'm sure, in my imagination, he was aiming for Malchus's head. But Malchus either ducked or he swerved, and all that happened was Malchus's ear severed, hits the ground. Listen, one of the greatest, most loving and compassionate miracles in the Bible is when Jesus picked up a warm, bloody ear and he reattached it to the head of Malchus. If Jesus healed his enemy, how many believe Jesus will heal his friends? If that isn't love, I don't know what love is. He washed his disciples' feet. He healed Malchus's ear. Here's the third one. Jesus forgave his own murderers in one of the seven statements from the cross. Luke 23:24, Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He didn't just forgive the Jews who conspired his death. He didn't just forgive the Romans who executed his death. Let me tell you, my friend, he forgave every sinner whose sin made his death necessary that day. And that includes us. We were the enemies of God, but Jesus forgave us from the cross. Colossians 1:21 says, "You were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he redeemed." If Jesus forgave his enemies, how many believe he'll forgive his own children? And I know the battle. I know what the devil does with our condemnation in our mind. He'll say, now that you are saved and you mess up, that's it. Three strikes, you're out. But let me tell you, my friend, if Jesus would forgive his own enemies, how much more will he forgive those that love him? Hallelujah. How many love him today? All right, here's the last one. If that isn't love, I don't know what is. Number four, Jesus saved the cursing crook from the cross. I call it a tale of two thieves. Two criminals were crucified with Jesus on Good Friday. They hung in naked shame and agony on cruel crosses for 6 hours. Both blasphemed Christ at first, spewing insults against him. Then one had a change of heart. One was saved, the other was lost. One was forgiven, the other was condemned. One went to heaven, one went to hell. One's heart was hardened by hate, the other's heart was melted by love. Hallelujah. One cursed God with his dying breath, the other whispered a soul-saving prayer. What made the difference? Can't you just see that criminal hanging there with hate in his eyes, spewing out insults, cursing God? And then he sees Jesus forgive his own murderers, his own executioners. That had to make an impact on him. And all of a sudden, his eyes were open. He realized, hey, this fella's different. There's something different about this man. And he realized this was the Son of God. And he prays, listen, he prays a 9-word prayer. You think you got to pray an hour or two to get a hold of God? He prayed 9 words. Think about it. If you're sincere and your heart is right after God, listen to what he said. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. That's all he said. And the only thing that he and Jesus had in common was their method of execution, crucifixion. One was a criminal, the other was the just judge of all the earth. One was guilty as sin, the other was the only innocent man to ever live. And that thief, though crucified on the earth for his crimes, now walks a free man in heaven. Ooh, hallelujah. You know why? Because God showed him love. God reached down and brought him out of that pit he was in. If God forgave a thief on the cross, how many believe God will forgive you today? If that isn't love, I don't know what is. If Jesus saved and redeemed a desperate dying thief, how much more will he help us today? I want you to stand with me this morning. Honey, I want us to sing that song again. Oh, how I love Jesus. And I want us to respond to his love. His arms are open today. If you need healing, if you need forgiveness, if you need salvation, if you need God to intervene in your life in some way, his arms are open wide. He will help you. But why don't you just take a moment and express your love for him today? Thank you, Lord. Proving you didn't just say it, you showed it, you demonstrated it. Hallelujah. We need you today. We call on you today. We honor you in this house. Sing it with me. And oh, how I love Jesus. I'm singing, oh. Hello everyone, this is Pastor Ben Godwin, thanking you for watching our broadcast today. I pray it has been a blessing and a source of spiritual enrichment for you and your family. I'd like to invite you to visit and subscribe to our YouTube channel, where you can view many more singing and preaching videos. Search for Good Springs Full Gospel Church at youtube.com. Also, please visit our website at goodspringsfgc.org. where you can learn more about our church and ministry, read many of my articles on a variety of subjects, find a direct link to our YouTube channel, shop our online store, and donate to our church and help support our TV ministry with debit, credit card, or PayPal. Also, you can mail in an offering the old-fashioned way to Good Springs Full Gospel Church, P.O. Box 3161, Jasper, Alabama 35502. If we can assist you in any way in your spiritual journey, please contact us. And remember, when all else fails, God's word works.